It was a huge legacy left by the first season, what these guys did in Queenstown, Glenorchy. I guess just I was just a big fan. So when I read what Jane and Jared had created for season two, I was very surprised, but I was very adrenalized by it. It was very, it was an electric read. And I just kind of, I thought if there was any way that we could bring this to life and give the audience the feeling I'm getting reading this thing, then it could be quite special. Totally fell in love with these characters. And you could just feel bursting off the page how much love these guys put into creating these characters. So I think it's a really unique detective show. We called it more of a hormonal detective show. It kind of revels in the moments when the characters and the detectives are not talking about the case. And I think it just adds for a really deep kind of human detective story, one where as the detective gets deeper into the case, she gets kind of deeper into her own past. I think the Robin that we meet at the start of season two is the kind of most vulnerable and most kind of defensive Robin that we've seen. And she's kind of just obsessed about her work. And she's kind of closed down quite emotionally. So I think what makes her really unique throughout the season is how raw and how vulnerable and kind of the deep places she goes.
The thing about Elizabeth as our detective is that she's got she's such a subtle performer that she keeps a straight face through all these different types of drama. You know, it goes from satire to straight detective story to dysfunctional family story to, you know, finding the body and all those kind of thing. And she's the glue that you go through that world with. And no matter what tone that we've decided to take at that particular time, she can hold the middle ground all the time. We think of these shows as novels, and the experience we're trying to give to people, ideally, is to be in the same room with 300 other people and watch a story that will unfold on a normal working day with a lunch break and all that sort of thing, you know. That's what excites me, to make an atmosphere where you're going to have a group binge viewing, you know. And it's great to feel the emotional mood of the whole room, and it really is a bonding experience for people. So, you know, that's what kept me going in season two. And also, we seem to have just fallen onto this kind of tone where we've mixed dark themes with a sense of humour. And it's great to see that play out, you know, on the big screen. Well, I'd love to do a third season, yeah. I think we've got plenty of ideas. It's just a matter of getting the one idea that's really going to electrify us.
Play the character of Puss. He is in the story. He's the boyfriend of Mary, played by Alice Englert. Mary is a child of Robin. It all makes sense when you see it. Robin was the lead in the first season. She's the lead in this one too. I am much older. The character is much older, and I am much older than the girlfriend. So that's a bit disturbing for some people. And Puss himself is a very extraordinary character. He lives above a brothel. He is friends with many sex workers. He has many cats. He has six different cats, or three or something. And he's very anti-establishment. He's anti-family. He's anti-love, in a way. He turns all our values upside down, I'd say. And he is an outcast. And I think he wants to be an outcast in society as we know it. He's definitely a guy that you wouldn't want to... You cross the street when you see him walking on your side of the pavement. And he wears his socks and his sandals. And he has a very strong accent. He's German and he's read many books. He's an academic and many theories about how society should be put together. And for many in the show, for many other characters in the show, they talk a lot about him. And I think for many viewers might feel a bit provoked by him and a bit, maybe a bit uncomfortable even. Hopefully they will be that. Yeah, Alice, I worked closely with her, and she's, of course, the daughter of Jane, so I just felt Jane Campion, so I felt I was immediately sucked into that family. And I was in very good hands. Jane Campion reached out to me already in the auditioning process, so very early on, I felt like a part of the project, and I felt very comfortable in that. I was very happy with the role she had written and that she had chosen me to perform for her. Alice was a great colleague, and working with all these Asian sex workers was quite good too, apart from the marvelous cast and Ari Kleiman, the other director, Nicole Kidman, Elizabeth Moss. Gwendolyn and I didn't have any scenes together, but I do really love her performance in the show. I think it's to be viewed upon as an entire film. It looks like a very long film, just cut into episodes, and that is in a way unique when it comes to television genres that are more episodical in a way. So that's special with this, and I think it's the bravery of the writing and the directing that, I mean, once you just watch the trailer, if you don't watch the entire show, you'll see that the characters, they talk in a, they do random stuff, weird stuff, quirky stuff. I think, and it takes some bravery to have the characters do these things that at least my character does, but even actually all of the other characters as well. And that's when it's a bit, or quite a bit different from mainstream television drama, where you try to nail a genre very fast. You say this is a comedy, or you say this is a crime story, and then you have a gallery of personas or characters that are more or less predictable. I'd say in this show they're all completely unpredictable, and in this show you could actually make spin-off series on any character if you were in the mood to. First of all, the writing. I read the scripts, and on page 16, and it's always when you read scripts, when certain characters are introduced, important characters, it says, oh, in comes a journalist. He's wearing blue shirts and this and that. So you start building there. In this case, it said, here comes Puss. He has a flamboyant flair to him. He has long hair, greasy hair, and he has a European way of dressing, whatever that means, is what's shot in Australia. And then it said a very funny line, the look on his face is that of a man who has just been insulted. And he has not been insulted. It's just, and it said a lot about a person who wakes up in the morning feeling, you know, like everything is a big insult to him. The world is a big insult. The sun is an insult to him. And that got my creativity going. That got my impulses, woke them up. And then it was, of course, a certain process with the wig. I'm wearing a wig. I'm a balding gentleman. And finding the right costume to this person, this European style. And that actually took a while. And I must say, confess, I drew inspiration from The Young Ones, the Rick Mayall show that we got back home in Copenhagen. Because he is somehow related to these people, these students who are stuck with their books and the way of carrying themselves, how their lives and their ideas are so based on theories they've read in books. So I drew some inspiration from the way they looked.
Jane Campion is celebrated, and rightly so. Can you talk a little bit about what makes her such a very special storyteller and your experience of working with her on this project?
Well, I'd say that the fact that she's very engaged in the story, she's very present, she has complete ownership of it, she wrote it all, and she also has releases responsibility to Ari, the other director, but also to me. I feel empowered, I feel that I own my role. She would ask me, what do you think the character would do here and this and that, and I think she has a bravery when it comes to exposing characters and humans in her films. With all their faults, she doesn't strike me as a director who's so engaged in making genre films. Fine, this is a crime story. You will see that for yourselves. But to me, that's not her. That's not what I find that interesting. I like the humanity of it all. the way she actually invests in all the characters. And I think that is something very unique for her, that every character, even you will find, you know, EP3 starts with a wonderful character eating some custard pie. And it's just really, really fun to watch people you don't even know when they've been directed by Jane. When you look at it, the strength of, for instance, Elizabeth Moss, to my taste, is that she's a superb actress who manages to enhance or to embrace both the masculine and the feminine sides to being human. And I think that's a rare quality that she actually has in that sense. You know, when she's angry, she's just angry. She doesn't cry, which is quite sometimes happens to female actors. And as a male actor, you suffer from the same problems, that you get caught up in ways of acting and ways of behaving that are gender specific. And I must say that I find that Puss could, in a way, have been a woman as well. Somehow. I mean, he always looks like a woman, had he shaven and worn high heels. So I think that is maybe one of the true qualities of Jane, that she actually creates a drama and creates characters that are, they're not gender unspecific, but they're on the way of going there. I am in a show called Follow the Money back home in Denmark. I don't know if they're going to screen it here. And I am doing another BBC show called Mac Mafia. Shooting it right now, actually, here in Britain and in Croatia.
I play Mary, and it's difficult because I don't know how much to reveal without revealing our story, but I think you can gather from the trailer that I am somebody's daughter, a few people's daughter. Mary is the child of Robin Griffin, the detective and our leading lady in this story. Who she gave up for adoption when she was 16 years old. And in this series, we reunite. And Mary is she's a schoolgirl, and she's struggling to find some way to feel control over her life and to find something of her own. And that thing is her boyfriend, Puss, who she... decided to love completely and utterly, no matter how bad he might seem objectively or to her parents or to Robin. It was really great to work with David, because he's a wonderful actor, and I think deciding in playing Mary in love with Puss, it was sort of like I had to give in to the religion of Puss, and from that point I had to believe in him, no matter what, which I did. And we had kind of a lot of fun. Like, I think our own relationship is, I don't know, more like friendly. Not as weird, I guess, as in the project. Our relationship as actors was actually very easy. And easygoing, but I think what's interesting about the relationship that Mary and Puss have in the second installment of Top of the Lake is, I think it's disturbing because actually it's genuine. There is love there. This is not just an exploitative, oh my God, sorry, my relationship, you know? It's not just sex, it actually does have love, and I think that that's why it's interesting, because it's showing you can love someone and it can go really wrong, and you can treat them really badly no matter how much you love them. And I think that it's confusing and it's mysterious, and I think that that is what I liked about playing this character. And what about playing that relationship? I love Elizabeth Moss, and I love Nicole Kidman, and I love Gwendolyn. Oh my God, they are all amazing people and amazing actresses. Nicole, Lizzie, and Gwendolyn make me want to be an actress, you know, like, because they are committed and they are strong and they are vulnerable, and I think this series is really. The characters are so they're so huge. And what happens is that you're challenged all the time to consider and then reconsider how you feel about each one of them. And I feel like they express that completely and perfectly, those women. I loved working with Ariel Kleiman. He's hilarious and he's got a great goofy grin, and he's also really good. He is somebody who, as a director, is actually really good at giving direction. And I know that sounds simple, but actually it's not, because he can really see into the scene and into a moment. And when he talks to you, it's about what to find next or what to explore next, it always feels of the moment. It always feels like the right thing. It's exciting to feel like someone is wanting to take your work further into a place that you're also hoping to go. Both installments, I think they're both original, and they both they can kind of exist on their own, as we saw when we were in Cannes. It seemed like a lot of people were excited and happy to sit through the complete 6 hours, even if they had been lacking the first six. I don't know if they'll make a third one or not, because they only make them if they have ideas, good ideas for it. So I don't know, it's like Jane and Jared will find out. I mean, there are so many amazing characters in season one, and they are absent from season two because Top of the Lake isn't sentimental, and it doesn't just give you what you want to see. It gives you something that you didn't even think or imagine you'd see. So I don't know how they would do a third installment. And yeah, of course, like it'd be such a pleasure to be in it. But I feel like they've got to do what they've got to do, you know? If they do it, whatever, they'll do it the right way.
I had long been a fan of Top of the Lake. I absolutely loved the first season. I thought it was a really exceptional piece of work. And Jane and I have a friend in common, and she put us in touch with each other. And I expressed my long-found love and admiration of Jane. And a few months later, she contacted me saying that she had written a part for me in the new series, which was an absolutely wonderful thing to have happened to me. I could not have been happier about that. Miranda is, she was a challenge for me to play. She is a very vulnerable character. She is a woman who isn't really succeeding at life. She's finding life very difficult. She's quite alienated. She doesn't have many or any friends. And she finds life very difficult and struggles to be good at anything at all. It can be quite painful to play a part like that. Particularly when it's been created for you. But I just found it to be such a fascinating exploration of womanhood, of what it is to be a particular type of woman, a woman that doesn't feel represented, a woman that feels maligned, a woman that's struggling, that doesn't feel supported. So it was a brilliant acting challenge. After the amazing parts I've had in things like Game of Thrones and Star Wars, of women of real strength, I was desperate for a challenge. And I'd said to Jane, I would really love a challenge next, and I got one.
You're working alongside an amazing cast. I mean, particularly, can you talk about working with Elizabeth, because your relationship with her is very crucial for both characters, I think.
I loved working with Lizzie, and it was such a real privilege, really. I had long admired Lizzie's work, and I absolutely adored her in the first Top of the Lake as well. I thought she was just exceptional. And I remember saying to people, she's great, that girl. She's so good in that show. I was very nervous about working with Lizzie because she's just so accomplished. She was hugely generous. And I really loved having the opportunity to work with someone who is so invested in the material and so invested in making it alive and taking risks and embracing the challenge. And I loved every second of it. And also, she was a lot of fun. We had a whole ton of fun together. And it was most wonderful being able to laugh with someone. Well, Jane's exceptional, isn't she? She's an auteur. And it was so interesting seeing her standing up there with all those men at the 70th anniversary of Cannes. There she was, the only woman to have ever won. I think what is brilliant about Jane's work is that it leaves you questioning. Long after you've left this, watching the screen, you thinking about the things that it's brought up, whether it's the images or the writing, just the way in which one particular character has behaved. It gives you so much pause to think and to really explore what the work might be about. This season explores so many themes: femininity, what it is to be a mother, mothers and daughters, friends, the intensity of a female relationship, the intensity of a workplace, death, birth. It's all in there, but it's also all wrapped up in a really gripping and thrilling and entertaining, bizarrely entertaining and strangely odd crime thriller. And that's what's so great about Jane's work. It's all a contradiction. I think really what people want to see is something other than the conventional now. I think that people are, may I say, a little bored of the homogenized view of the world that we seem to be been given a lot of until maybe the last few years. Brienne of Tarth is an incredible character. We see a woman who is unconventional. She's not conventionally attractive. She is not cute. She is not sexy. She is none of those things that gain you value points in our society. But she uses all of the skills that she does have to overcome that obstacle. And she, I think we all love to see the underdog triumph. And I think that Brienne of Tarth is, I think Brienne of Tarth encapsulates the underdog that all of us feel, or many of us feel more than others, and overcoming that obstacle. And I think that that's why we feel so delighted, is that we see for once in our lives those of us that feel left outside come out on top. I am over the moon to be part of Star Wars. I mean, I know everybody has always loved the films. I've loved them since I was 6 years old. Ryan is a brilliant director and a joy just to be around. So intelligent, forensic, but so warm and open. And I'm particularly delighted to play a character that, again, doesn't conform to traditional female norms. Even to the point that I remember Kathy Kennedy and I had a conversation where she said, "Have you ever Googled female heroines?" And she showed me the results, and they were all women who were scantily clad. And I was particularly excited of the opportunity, just even as a concept, to have a woman where we respond to her not on the basis of how she looks at all. Not at all. It's just her actions. And I felt that that was a bold, brave, and necessary move for Star Wars to make, and I'm so proud to be a part of that.
We find her back in Sydney. She's back on the force. She's trying to find a case so that she can throw herself into her work. And that's where she's happiest. That's where she feels comfortable and at home. She does find a case, which is this unidentified body of a woman washed up on the shore on Bondi Beach. And then fortunately or unfortunately, that case gets very tied up in her personal life that she's trying to run away from. And how I felt about coming back. I mean, I love this character so much. Even talking about her as much as I have been the past few days makes me miss her and want to play her again, you know? So she's great. She's so strong and smart and badass, but also really vulnerable and sensitive and closed off. It's just a really challenging character for me. So I was just, you don't often get to come back and revisit a character unless you're on a series. And so this was a great opportunity.
And one of the other great rewards of being a part of this series is the people you get to work alongside. Obviously, we've had a bit of a change of the guard from the first season. Can you talk a little bit about, I guess, particularly Alice and Gwendolyn as your new kind of partners in crime?
Yeah. Literally, quite literally, Gwen is my partner in crime in Miranda. She's a magnificent woman, Gwen herself. We become dear friends. We fell madly in love. I feel inspired by her personally and professionally. To get to have a female counterpart with China Girl was really wonderful for me. It was something that I didn't even know that I missed until I got it. Getting that female relationship, that female dynamic, and having somebody to play off of was just so cool and fun. And it's my favorite arc in China Girl, you know? And then Alice was really interesting because when I met her 4 or 5 years ago during the first season, the first thought I had was, oh, she's Robin. And I kind of got where Robin came from Jane. So for her to then play my daughter, to play Robin's daughter, is kind of it's just a perfect move. She's a very, very smart, sweet, funny girl that I've become friends with now. And it's cool because we feel more like friends than a mother-daughter relationship, which I think is actually really great for Robin and Mary. I would say what I discovered in the first series that makes her special and that makes her good at what she does is she's a truth seeker. She can tell if someone's lying. And she can just feel it in her bones. She can just feel if something's wrong, which is really fun to play. To play walking into a room and just feeling like something is just off in that space. And that's what she has that I think makes her a great detective. She can just tell. And she can just look in someone's eyes and just see that something is wrong and they're hiding something. And that's what makes her brilliant. Then she's got a hell of a lot of flaws that don't necessarily help her in her personal life. But that's what makes her good. And then the second season, honestly, that ability to see when someone's telling the truth, that ability to feel out a situation being wrong, not only saves her life, but saves, possibly her daughter's. There needs to be more female-centric pieces of art. There are a lot, which is fantastic, but there always needs to be more. Gwen says it in a great way. People like to see themselves reflected in the art that they watch. And there's a lot of women who go to the movies and a lot of women who watch television. And we want to see ourselves and we want to see an accurate reflection of that. We want to see all kinds of people, men and women, reflected back at us. And art needs to change in order to reflect how society's changing. So it's nothing but a fantastic thing for us. It's something we're very, very, very proud of.